Freedom to me means self-determination. It's the ability to choose. And I think that that's what we all should have a right to, and that's what we're all fighting for.
Public debate is vital in a democratic society because if the public doesn't take part, then the politicians take over and decide everything for themselves. And a place like the Bali is important because that's where the public gets to say what they think and shape their opinions and listen to debate.
It's incredibly important that people continue to speak out in this way.
Acknowledge the limitations and taking responsibility for questioning the limitations.
With knowledge comes a certain beauty. We are then in a position to take action on that.
Particularly in this very noisy, fast culture, what documentary does, I think, is to take time to make meaning.
Documentaire films en kunst in het algemeen is soms een plek waar de mening en waar de positie belangeloos is. Je mag er gewoon zijn, je mag leren. En de Bali is zo'n plek.
And goedenavond, good evening, everybody. Please don't forget to put your phone on silent mode. And the hashtag is the Bali. My name is Bahram Sadeghi, and I have the great honor and maybe greater responsibility to be your moderator, your host tonight. And on behalf of the Bali and Kurts and friends, I would say welcome. Welcome to the evening called Operation Olive Branch or Olive Tak. War, just or unjust war. As you can hear, English is not my first language. As a matter of fact, as someone who has lived for the first 18 years in Iran and now 32 years in Holland, I have no idea what my first or second or third language is. So please bear with me. But the whole evening will be more or less in English, Kurdish, Turks, and maybe Amsterdams. So that's a little bit Polish, probably, yeah, okay. So that would be for this part, but close to the end of the program, if there is room, we have room for questions from you, please don't hesitate to ask your question in whatever language you would like to ask, and there is probably someone here who can translate that. Having said that, the program. I will start a conversation, short conversation with the photographer Peter Blanken about his project in Diyarbakir and in Sur, the same. And after that, I will have a conversation with the eyewitness who has been there, seen the destruction in that area. And after that, we will have a small mini lecture about the legal perspective about the law of intervention in other countries, what Turkey does right now. Is it legal? Is it illegal? Is it a gray area? By a professor from Groningen, Marcel Brus. And the heart of the program, to put it that way, will be a panel discussion and with two members of the parliament and two other people, you will see them as well. And especially during that part, I will invite you to ask questions. I will come to you with a microphone because we are recording this and it's very important to speak in the microphone because if you don't do it, this is very important to speak in the microphone. Having said that, please allow me to just share some facts and figures with you about this Kurdish issue. And I'm sure that most of you know all this stuff, but maybe there is one or two people here in the room who doesn't have all this stuff clearly in the mind, or maybe you just don't know it, you know. So, for the next 5 minutes. Now, when we talk about Kurdistan was divided in 1923 between four countries, Iran, Iraq, Turkey, and Syria. There are about 40 million, so 40 million Kurds all over the world. And so that makes the Kurds about the largest people without any state. Het is het grootste volk zonder eigen land, de Koerden. And today we will zoom in northern part of Kurdistan, northern Kurdistan. So that's the Turkish part of the Kurdish region. It is home to about 20 million Kurds who are unfortunately politically and culturally oppressed. Their elected mayors and members of parliament, they are put in prison as prisoners of consciousness. And the current president of Turkey, Mr. Erdogan, he appears not to be very different from his predecessors. And nevertheless, until a few years ago, there were some peace talks. There were some conversations between the government of Turkey and the opposition party, HDP. By the way, as you probably all know, HDP is a party in Turkey which is pro-minorities. All minorities, so also the Kurdish minorities. And the other party we will mention a lot during the course of this evening is DBP, or used to be BDP, which is a Kurdish political party. So these are the parties we will talk about. And so let's go back to the peace talks in 2015, because of the murder on two Turkish policemen. The peace talks, while there was negotiation about investigation about this murder, the Turkish government, the authorities, they decided to stop the whole negotiation and declare the war against the Kurds, we can say again. And they say that probably the underlying reason was that the HDP party, they had reached the threshold for the parliament, the 10% threshold. So they were very popular during the for the elections in July, but also election in November. And it's very important to realize that it's very important that when you get the threshold for the parliament, so you are in the parliament. And by the end of 2015, a number of municipalities in the Kurdish regions in the east part, they are under the government of they are under the leadership of HDP and BDP. They declared self-determination, and the Turkish government, they reacted very harshly to that, and that led to the destruction of Diyarbakir's couple of districts of Diyarbakir, like Sur, Sizre, and Nusaybin. And the international community, they remained more or less silent at that moment, which gave Turkey a kind of license to go on, because there was no resistance from the other countries. So they even tried to go outside the country. And that's a very important notion for us, because we are talking also about Turkey, their presence in Syria. And you probably have heard all about Afrin, a Kurdish city in Syria, which fell victim to this destruction at the beginning of January 2018. So that's the background, the political geographic background of the region, of the event. With that, I would like to ask Piet den Blanke to join me here for a short conversation about his project and his exhibition. Piet, would you please take that microphone, please? Okay. Piet, tell me, what's your exhibition? I've just seen it upstairs. What, when, how, why?
In 2017, I traveled for a couple of weeks to the eastern part of Turkey and to Diyarbakir to make photos to show the destruction of Sur and to show the to make pictures, to make portraits of the victims who suffered the aggression against this area.
How easy or difficult was it at that time for you to get in Sur, or could you go freely everywhere you want to go?
Well, I could move rather easily, but one of the things what I was surprised of is that everybody was very, very afraid. And the first 2 days I went with Thailand, he went with me, but after 2 days he didn't want to continue because his family was too afraid and he went back. And then I got in contact with an English teacher who lived in Diyarbakir, not in Sur, but in another area. And he went with me 4 or 5 days, and we intended to travel and the map is gone.
Maybe we can get the map back, please.
Yeah, no, but possible? I have the name. Yeah.
Okay,
to Sisra and to Nusragin. And after 2 days of talking with other people, he decided not to go because he was too afraid.
Yeah.
And after 4 or 5 days walking through Sur, he decided to let's stop because it's too dangerous.
Yeah. Pete, you have been you have been around the block, you know. You have been all over the world, you know. I saw, you know, I visited your website.
It was the first time I was in the eastern part of Turkey.
Yeah. So tell me, in which way was it? Did you see any similarities or any differences with your other project? You know, people who are getting, you know, attacked, who are oppressed, who are afraid. Did you any similarities or differences with other projects?
Well, I think there are similarities because, one of the things which was exceptional is that I found so many people afraid. Visiting people, not in Sur, but in other areas, they asked me, come in quickly, don't go to the balcony, because the neighbors can see us. Okay. So this kind of fear, that was especially in Diyarbakir.
Yeah. Especially when you think about the fact that you are in a democratic country, you know, and with the elections and everything, and that's a country that, you know, in one way or another, you know, they want to be a member of European European community, and we want them as well, you know, and then to being afraid, you know, like self-censurist, eh?
Yeah, yeah,
self-censorship.
Yeah, yeah. That was really, really strong. The Jaja, who wanted to go with me to the border with Iraq, he told me I can't go because I have a wife and family and a job, and when they arrest me, they can accuse me of helping terrorism, and they can jail me for that 7 or 8 years. Yeah. I can't take that risk, and of course I can understand that.
Okay, finally about your project. About the exhibition right now. So, till when people can see the exhibition? For how many days or week will it be here?
It will be here until next Wednesday.
Yeah.
So 1 week and a half. After that, it will move to Brussels, to the European Parliament.
Wow.
And in autumn, it will be in the atrium in The Hague municipality.
Good, good for you. By the way, if we are finished tonight, so let's say about 10:15, can we get a private tour?
Yes, of course.
So if people want to get more information,
we can walk around the pictures, and I can explain.
Cool, that's a promise.
Okay.
Cool. Thank you very much, Pio. Thank you. As I said, you know, I will have an eyewitness conversation with Nursul Aydogan. Nursul, and the translator for tonight, he's not a professional translator. We just told him, you know, you can get four free drinks, so he will do it for us. Yeah. Erdal Sahin, would you please join me here? Okay, you go over there. Erdal in the middle, and I'm going to sit here. Okay, let's even kijken. Ben ik goed? Ja, goed te verstaan. Ja, so I have some water for my friend Erdal. Would you like to have that one? Yeah, cool. Yeah, okay, cool. She has the other microphone. Is it okay? Yeah, okay. Nursul Aydogan, you are a former member of the parliament for HDP in Diyarbakir. And would you please tell me, when did you start working as a member of parliament for HDP in Diyarbakir? And what was your, how was your daily life at that time?
Sayın Nursel Aydoğan, siz Diyarbakır HDP milletvekilisiniz. Bize biraz Diyarbakır'dan oraya gidişinizi ve orada neler yaptığınızı bize anlatır mısınız?
Ben öncelikle bugün bu çok değerli ve önemli toplantıya katılan herkesi saygıyla, sevgiyle selamlıyorum.
Om te beginnen wil ik iedereen die hier aanwezig is van harte welkom heten.
Ja, oh ja, we gaan dus in het Nederlands, Engels alles door elkaar praten, hè? Dus vanaf de ja. Oké. Okay.
Okay. Burada bulunmaktan, sizlerle bir arada olmaktan duyduğum memnuniyeti ifade etmek isterim.
Ik wil heel graag duidelijk maken dat ik echt blij ben om hier te zijn, om samen met jullie te zijn vanavond.
Çünkü bugün burada Sur ve Sur'da yaşananları konuşacağız.
We gaan het vandaag namelijk hebben over Sur district van Diyarbakir en wat daar allemaal is gebeurd.
Sur'da yaşananlar hiçbir zaman sıradan şeyler değildi.
De gebeurtenissen in Sur zijn absoluut geen gebeurtenissen die zomaar zomaar zijn.
Nasıl bir Vietnam tarihe geçtiyse, nasıl bir Stalingrad direnişi tarihe geçtiyse, Sur'da bu anlamıyla tarihe geçmelidir.
Net als hoe Vietnam oorlog de geschiedenisboeken is ingegaan, net als hoe Stalingrad geschiedenisboeken is ingegaan, is Diyarbakir Sur district ook geschiedenisboeken ingegaan.
Maar Nursel, de landen die je noemt, of de steden die je noemt, dat was tijdens een oorlog met een bezetter. Dit is het leger van het land zelf.
Ama sizin bahsettiğiniz Stalingrad olsun, ondan sonra Vietnam olsun, orada işgalci güçlerle savaşıldı. Sizin bahsettiğiniz yerlerde onların kendi ülkesi.
Dit is het leger van jouw land.
Senin ülkenin askeri.
Bu sorularınıza cevap vereceğim. Kısa bir giriş anlamında bunu ifade etmek istedim.
Ik ga zo meteen antwoord geven op uw vraag. Ik wil als eerst even een opening.
Evet. Bugün burada resim sergisini biraz önce hep birlikte gezdik. Sur'da yaşananların tarihe geçmesi anlamında bence çok önemli bir çalışma, çok değerli bir çalışma.
We zijn vandaag ook de foto sessie zijn we even langs geweest en ik vind het een heel belangrijk werk wat meneer heeft geleverd, ook foto's die we hebben gezien.
Çünkü Sur direnişi Kürt halkının özgürlük mücadelesi tarihinde çok önemli bir yeri teşkil ediyor.
Want de Sur district heeft in de Koerdische bevolking heeft een hele belangrijke plaats. Is een belangrijke plaats voor de Koerdische bevolking en heeft dan ook een belangrijke plek onder de Koerden.
Ja. Evet. Bu biçimiyle tarihe geçmesinde çok değerli arkadaşımızın yaptığı bu çalışma bizim için çok değerli ve anlamlı, önemli.
En daarom is voor ons heel erg belangrijk het werk wat meneer heeft geleverd is heel erg belangrijk voor ons. Ja. Ook voor ons volk natuurlijk.
Ja.
Evet. Ben Diyarbakır milletvekiliyim. 2011 yılından beri 6 yıldır Diyarbakır'da milletvekili yapıyorum.
Ik ben parlementariër in Diyarbakır en ik ben 6 jaar lang ben ik parlementariër geweest in Diyarbakır.
Ja. Oké. Okay. Die vraag van mij over de vergelijking die ze maakte over met Stalingrad en met Vietnam. Weet je hoe zij dat ziet? Dat zij door haar eigen leger aangevallen wordt.
Şimdi ben demin soruyu sordum. Stalingrad ve Vietnam'la ilgili. Siz kendi askeriniz tarafından saldırıya uğradınız ve bunu nasıl görüyorsunuz?
Tabii bu saldırılar yeni değil. Türkiye'de Kürt sorunun çözümsüzlüğü nedeniyle tam 40 yıldır PKK ile Türkiye Cumhuriyeti Devleti arasında çatışmalar yaşanıyor.
Deze aanvallen van het Turkse van het Turkse leger is niet nieuw. Ongeveer 40 jaar lang is het Turkse leger in oorlog met de PKK.
Bu düşük yoğunluklu bir savaş olarak da nitelendirildi devlet tarafından.
En het is altijd heeft het een door de Turkse overheid is het altijd als iets minder waardig gezien.
Ja. Ja. Oké. Okay. Was jij tijdens de aanvallen was je zelf ook in Sur in Diyarbakır? Was je daar ter plekke?
Saldırı olduğu zamanlar siz kendiniz Sur'da bulundunuz mu? Orada mıydınız?
Evet, Sur'da 21 Ağustos 2015 tarihinde Sur'da yaşayan gençlik ve orada yaşayan halk ilk hendekleri kazmaya başladı.
21 Augustus 2015 is het in Sur is het begonnen.
Hendekler ve barikatların oluşumu 2 Aralık tarihine kadar sürdü.
De barricades van de bevolking is tot heeft tot 2 maart heeft het geduurd.
Ja. Yani 21 Ağustos'la
December, sorry.
December, okay.
21 Ağustos'la 2 Aralık tarihine kadar hendekler ve barikatlar olmasına rağmen AKP ve Erdoğan hükümeti müdahale etmedi.
Tot dus van 21 augustus 2015 tot 2 december 2015 waren de barricades en de AK-partij regering en dus president Erdoğan heeft toen helemaal niks gedaan.
Ja. Ben milletvekiliyim tabii Diyarbakır'ın. Ama Sur'da başlayan bu direnişten sonra zamanımın çok büyük çoğunluğunu Diyarbakır'da geçirdim. Meclise gitmedim.
Ik ben tijdens mijn 6-jarige parlementariërschap ben ik heel weinig naar Ankara, dus naar het parlement van Turkije geweest, omdat ik voornamelijk in Sur, dus in Diyarbakır gebleven.
21 Ağustos'ta başlayan 12 Mart'a kadar devam eden bu direniş süresi boyunca 6 ay büyük çoğunlukla Diyarbakır'daydım ve Diyarbakır'da Sur'da yaşananların birebir tanığım ve şahidiyim.
Ik heb alles zelf ook meegemaakt, ook gezien. Het was een periode van 21 augustus tot 12 maart. En 21 augustus 2015 tot 12 maart 2016. Ja. En ik ben in die periode ben ik ook daar gebleven. Ja.
Ik
was samen met het volk.
Ja. Ik kan me herinneren in die tijd dat er heel weinig mensen daar naartoe mochten gaan om verslag van te doen. Dat was een soort no-go area. Klopt dat? Ja, dat er niemand daar naartoe mocht om verslag te doen naar het buitenland.
O zamanlar yabancı yabancı basın dahil yani ok, şey yerli basın yabancı basın dahil oraya giriş yasakları oldu. Öyle doğru mu bu?
Tabii ki. 2 Aralık'tan itibaren Sur'da sokağa çıkma yasağı başladı.
Na 2 december was er een avondklok in Sur district van Diyarbakır.
Sur'da 22.500 insan yaşıyor 6 mahallede. Sur'un yarısıdır burası.
Sur is een stadsdeel van Diyarbakır en daar wonen 22.500 mensen in 6 verschillende wijken.
Sokağa çıkma yasağı başladığında halkın tamamı mahallelerde ve evlerindeydi.
Toen de avondklok startte, waren veel mensen die ook in de wijk woonden, die bleven daar ook in hun huis. Dus die gingen niet weg.
Ja.
Tabii ki sokağa çıkma yasağı başladıktan sonra gerek ulusal gerekse uluslararası basının ilgisi çok yoğun oldu.
Toen dus mensen niet meer de straat op mochten, zagen we ook dat de internationale media ook hun aandacht gingen richten op ons.
Ja.
Ancak öylesine bir baskı politikası vardı ki basın dahil dışarıdan gelen Avrupa Birliği'nden gelen, Avrupa Konseyi'nden gelen milletvekilleri dahi Sur bölgesine alınmıyordu.
Er was zoveel druk en door die druk zagen we ook dat Europarlementariërs, dus mensen van het Europese parlement, ook van de internationale media groepen, die mochten dus niet Sur binnen.
Örneğin Katipiri gelmişti, Avrupa Konseyi Türkiye raportörü olarak yasaklı bölgelerin civarına dahi yaklaştırılmadı.
PvdA Europarlementariër Katipiri, die was ook Türkiye raportör, zij was ook gekomen naar Sur, maar zij mocht ook niet Sur binnen.
Birleşmiş Milletler temsilcileri yaşananları yerinde görmek için gelmek istediler. Asla izin verilmedi.
Ook de Verenigde Naties wilden mensen komen, maar die wilden dus delegaties komen, maar die mochten ook niet naar binnen.
Çünkü AKP hükümeti ve diktatör Erdoğan asla halka yönelik yaptığı bu saldırıların bilinmesini ve görülmesini istemiyordu.
Want de AK Parti regering en president Erdoğan die wilde dus niet dat druk die ze uitoefende op de mensen, op het volk, dat dat gezien zou worden.
Ja, zij is ook dictator Erdoğan.
Dictator Erdoğan mı dediniz?
Dat zei je.
Evet, biz dictator Erdoğan.
Ja, wij zeggen dictator Erdoğan.
Ja, en ja, dat is overal volgens mij. Allemaal hetzelfde. Oh, ze luisteren ook mee. Ja, inderdaad, ja. Oké. Even kijken, Nursel. Ik weet niet hoe ik die vraag moet stellen zonder erg naar bloedigheden en dode mensen en ellende te vragen, maar ik ga het toch stellen.
Ben soruyu sormadan önce bu soruyu kansız ve ölüm olmadan nasıl soracağımı düşünüyorum ama yine de soracağım.
Ik ga het toch stellen.
Ja. Yine de soracağım.
Hoe ziet die aanval, die oorlog, de vernietiging, de destructie eruit? Hoe kan je het aan ons uitleggen hoe dat eruit ziet, hoe het voelt?
Bize o baskıların, o oradaki olan olayları, ölümleri, bize onu anlatabilir misiniz? Nasıl bir his?
Tabii ki inanın anlatması son derece zor.
Het is heel erg moeilijk om het te vertellen.
Orada öyle büyük insanlık suçları işlendi ki bunu görmek, yaşamak çok farklı bir şey ve bir şey yapamamak insanı en fazla üzen ve kahreden bir şey.
Het meest erge is dat je door al die dingen die zijn gebeurd, dus door alle doden die zijn gevallen, door alles wat er is meegemaakt, dat je zelf als mens zijnde niks kan doen. En dat is het meest erge.
Ja.
Sur'da bir operasyon yapılmadı. Onu öncelikle söyleyeyim.
Ik wil als eerst zeggen
operasyon
dat,
demek yanlış.
Ik wil als eerst zeggen dat in Sur dat er geen operatie was. Ik zie het niet als een operatie. Dus het is fout om te zeggen dat het een operatie was.
Ja. 22 bin kişinin yaşadığı bir şehir merkezi, evler, sokaklar en ağır silahlarla vuruldu.
Een district waar 22.500 mensen wonen, is met de meest erge wapens is gebruikt. En met de meest erge wapens is het district gebombardeerd.
Gebombardeerd?
De insan bazen böyle bir şey olabilir mi diye düşünüyor.
Ja. Soms denk je als mens zijn van, kan dit gebeuren? Ja. Hoe kan dit gebeuren?
Ja. Evet, ja. Evet. Havan topları ve bomba atarlarla bir şehir yerle bir edildi.
Ja, dus antwoord op je vraag. Ja. Dus gebombardeerd en is gewoon dus een stadsdeel in dit geval, een district, is gewoon plat gebombardeerd.
Ja. İlk bomba atıldığında bir eve isabet etmişti. 12 yaşındaki Helen isminde bir ilkokul öğrencisi yaşamını yitirmişti ve onlarca kişi yaralanmıştı.
Tijdens de eerste bombardementen was er een meisje van 12 jaar genaamd Helen Öldü, evet. Die is overleden. En heel veel mensen zijn toen ook meteen bij de eerste bombardementen gewond geraakt.
Ja.
Bu aşırı ağır silahların kullanılmasıyla tabii ki halk çok büyük bir paniğe kapıldı.
Doordat er dus wapens zijn gebruikt, is ook het volk is ook op dat moment ook meteen in paniek geraakt, omdat ze niet wisten van wat ze moesten doen, wat ze konden doen, wat er overkwam.
Yaralanan yurttaşlar yaralılarını da dışarı çıkarmak istiyorlardı ama sokağa çıkma yasağı olduğu için dışarıya çıkamıyorlardı.
Ook de mensen die gewond op dat moment gewond raakten mochten niet wisten ook niet wat ze moesten doen en ze konden ook niet naar buiten gaan.
Ja. Bizlere telefonla ulaştıklarında biz Diyarbakır Valiliğini onlarca kez aramamıza rağmen ne yazık ki yaralıların dışarı çıkartılmasıyla ilgili bir şey yapılmıyordu.
Wij hebben dus destijds ook telefonisch contact gehad met de mensen die daar op dat moment waren. En we hebben alles geprobeerd, ook met de overheid, om dit op te lossen, maar die hebben niet gereageerd op ons verzoek.
Çok fazla insan yaralanınca 10 Nisan günü 17 saatlik bir süre için sokağa çıkma yasağını kaldırdılar.
Omdat er zoveel mensen op dat moment gewond geraakt, mochten we voor 17 uur, mochten we op 10 april, mochten we voor 17 uur, mochten we dus het gebied binnen.
Okay. Halk büyük bir panikle yaşadıklarından kaynaklı evlerini ve mahallelerini terk etti. 20 bin kişi evinden tek bir şey alamadan, ihtiyacını alamadan, hatta çoğu kez terliksiz, ayakkabısız çıkmak zorunda kaldı. 20 bin kişi
20.000 mensen,
17 saatte Tsuru terk etti.
20.000 mensen die moesten op dat moment zonder iets ook van huis mee te nemen, moesten ze dus binnen die 17 uur. Dus het was niet alleen dat mensen van buiten naar binnen mochten, maar dat je ook natuurlijk vanuit binnen dus weg kon gaan, kon vluchten op dat moment. En dus binnen die 17 uur zijn 20.000 mensen zijn toen gevlucht uit Sur.
Waar naartoe zijn ze gegaan? Waar zijn die mensen?
Evet, 1990'lı yıllarda bu tip zorla göç etmelerde daha fazla Türkiye metropollerine göç oluyordu. İstanbul,
90,
Ankara, İzmir gibi.
Jaren 90 als dit soort omdat ze aangeeft dat dit niet dat dit ook in het verleden is gebeurd. En in de jaren 90 was het zo dat het dan automatisch dat de mensen dan naar metropoolsteden zoals Ankara of Istanbul gingen.
Ama bu kez öyle olmadı.
Maar dit keer was dat niet zo.
Çıkanların çoğu köylere, akrabalarının, eş ve dostlarının yanlarına gittiler.
De meeste die konden vluchten, die gingen naar dorpen in de buurt bij familie en vrienden verblijven.
Biraz parası olanlar kiralık bir ev tutup yerleştiler ve bizler de Diyarbakır halkı ve belediyelerimizle birlikte yerleşenlere çeşitli yardımlar yaptık.
De mensen die wat geld hadden, die konden dus naar vrienden, familie. Ja. Maar de mensen die dat niet hadden, hebben wij dus als gemeente Diyarbakır, hebben wij dus ook geholpen met een verblijfplaats.
Ja. En Nursel, ik wil het op dit moment hierbij houden. Maar zou je aan het eind van de avond nog een keer terug willen komen om te vertellen wat deze avond jou heeft gebracht?
Şu anda biz bunu bu bölümü sonlandırmak istiyorum. Size sorum, siz akşamın sonunda yani bitmeye yakın bize bu akşamdan ne gördüğünüzü, kendinizi nasıl hissettiğinizi bize anlatmak ister misiniz?
Tabii ki. Ama bu bölümü sonlandırmadan sadece bir iki tane örnek vererek Sur'da yaşanan vahşeti ben buradaki dostlarımıza anlatmak isterim.
Maar voordat we hiermee stoppen, zou ik nog enkele dingen willen vertellen over de gruwelijkheden. Wat er in Soer dus is gebeurd aan de mensen die hier zijn.
Ja, ik durf het niet te vragen, maar ja, doen ja. Ja. Ja, neem ons mee. Ja.
Aslında sormak bile istemiyorum ama anlatın bize.
Evet. Sur'un içerisinde kalan sivil halktan bir annemiz, fotoğraflarda da görülüyor, onun için anlatmak istedim. Fatma Ateş.
Je ziet ook, als we straks nog de foto's kunnen zien, is ook een mevrouw genaamd Fatma Ateş. Ja. En ik wil dus wat over haar vertellen.
Ja.
Evet. 56 yaşında, hatırladığım kadarıyla 6-7 çocuk annesi bir anne.
Ze is 56 jaar en ze heeft zijn moeder van 7 kinderen.
Evinde havan topuyla vurulduktan sonra ağır yaralanıyor.
Nadat er een bom op haar huis valt, is ze zwaar gewond op dat moment.
Ve onun evinin civarında 15 çocuk, yaşları 5, 6, 7 civarında 15 çocuk da kendisinin bulunduğu mahallede.
En ook 15 andere kinderen in datzelfde gebied. Waar zij woont.
O çocuklar da atılan bomba atarlarla havan toplarıyla yaralandılar.
Ook die kinderen zijn op dat moment ook gewond geraakt toen mevrouw dus Fatma Ateş op dat moment dus ook gewond was geraakt.
Sağlık görevlisi elbette olmadığı için çocukların yaraları orada bulunan halk tarafından normal bildiğimiz dikiş ve iğne ipliğiyle dikilip telefonundan resimleri çekilip bize gönderildi.
Omdat er geen hulpverlening was, hebben die mensen daar zelf gedaan wat ze konden doen. En dan over zelf gedaan bedoel ik dan met touw een wond dichtnaaien.
Biz bu görüntüleri alıp hepsini valiye götürdük. İçeridekilerin sivil insanlar olduğunu ve bu sivil insanların vurulduğunu, katledildiğini, öldürüldüğünü söyledik. Sivillerin tahliye edilmesi gerektiğini söyledik.
We hebben ook foto's gemaakt en we hebben ook duidelijk gemaakt ook aan de Turkse overheid dat dit dat die mensen daar uit moeten, uit het gebied moeten.
İşte tam o dönemde Türkiye'nin batısından aydınlar, yazarlar, sanatçılar bu insani durum için geldiler. Sivillerin tahliye edilebilmesi için valilikle görüşmeye geldiler, destek sunmaya geldiler bizlere.
Toen zijn vanuit het westen van Turkije zijn docenten, zijn artiesten, verschillende artiesten, dus de Turkse mensen uit het westen die met ons meeleefden, die zijn toen vanuit Istanbul, Ankara, die zijn toen naar Diyarbakır gekomen.
Mm-hmm. Aynı dönem Avrupa Birliği'nden pek çok milletvekili arkadaş da Diyarbakır'a geldi.
Ook vanuit het Europese parlement zijn verschillende vrienden vanuit het parlement, vanuit Brussel gekomen.
İşte hep birlikte valilik üzerinde oluşturduğumuz bu baskıdan, kamuoyu baskısından sonra bir koridor açılarak 65 sivil yurttaşı biz dışarıya çıkarabildik.
Na zoveel nationaal en internationaal druk konden wij 65 mensen vanuit het gebied dus naar buiten halen. Dus
bu çıkarma sırasında Fatma Ateş annemiz de ağır yaralandığı için ve çıkarıldıktan sonra ağır yaralı olmasına rağmen gözaltında tutulduğu için yaşamını yitirdi.
De mevrouw waar ik dus net over had, Fatma Ateş, die mocht op dat moment ook naar buiten. Alleen toen ze buiten kwam, werd ze gearresteerd en daardoor is ze ook overleden.
Çatışma bölgesi olmayan Sur'un diğer mahallelerine yaklaşık 500 metre öteden atılan bir havan topuyla evinde çocuklarıyla birlikte kahvaltı eden bir anne.
Ook een moeder die waar dus normaal heet er geen dus waar er geen maatregelen op waren, dus waar een gebied waar nog wat nog rustig was, Fansur, die is ook op dat moment is ook een moeder daar gewond geraakt omdat daar ook een bom op was gevallen.
Annenin kafası koptu ve odadan kahvaltı yaptığı salondan sokağa düştü kafası dışarıya.
Hoofd van de mevrouw werd ja. Ik vind het ook zo erg om dit ook zo op die manier te vertellen. Ja. Maar zij.
Kafası kopmuştu ve pencereden dışarıya çıkmıştı. Gövdeden ayrılıp yani sokağa
vermişti. Haar hoofd was gewoon vanuit het lichaam was
afgeschoten.
Ja.
Evet. Ja. Havan topunu mahalle halkı almıştı. Havan topu Türkiye Makina Kimya Endüstrisi yapımıydı.
Dat was een bom die ook in Turkije, dus in Turkije werd gemaakt.
Bizim
dus een nationale materiaal.
Nationale trots, ja.
Bizim ve Baro tarafından, insan hakları kuruluşları tarafından savcılığa teslim edilmesine rağmen bu zamana kadar bununla ilgili hiçbir soruşturma dahi yapılmadı.
Wij hebben dat ook via onze mensenrechtenorganisaties hebben we dat ook doorgegeven, maar is tot heden is er niks mee gedaan.
Tüm bu sivil katliamların üstü Erdoğan ve AKP hükümeti tarafından örtülmeye çalışılıyor halen.
Nog steeds worden die moorden worden door AK Parti regering en Tayyip Erdoğan dus wordt dat steeds gezegd dat het niet zo is en wordt
Nursel. Zoals ik zei, zou je alsjeblieft aan het eind van de avond terug willen komen? Ik ga met twee parlementariërs praten. Met een professor, met iemand van HDP uit het Europarlement. Ga ik met hem praten, kijken wat jij daarvan opvond.
Deminde,
een paar minuten.
Deminde sorduğum gibi biraz sonra burada HDP Avrupa temsilcisiyle ve iki tane Hollanda milletvekilliyle konuşacağım ve siz de o konuşmadan sonra bize fikrinizi anlatabilir misiniz birazdan?
Evet. Elbette.
Okay. Elbette. Maar voor nu, bij gebrek aan een beter woord, dank voor dit verhaal, voor je getuigenis en tot over 40 minuten.
Şimdilik teşekkürler ve 40 dakika sonra görüşme dileğiyle.
Thank you. Well,
teşekkür ederim.
Okay. Okay, teşekkür. Wel, dat is jacco. Oké, even kijken. Ik ga even de glazen even opruimen hier een beetje. Dit is hier. En nu is het moment aangekomen om. Oh, nee, Engels. Ja, Engels, ja. Even kijken, Erdoğan, zou je ondertussen ook kunnen vertalen een beetje hier en daar? Vooral straks het panelgesprek, maar het gesprek van zometeen ook. Zoals ik in het... Engels, ja. As I said in the beginning, we will continue in English. And I would like to ask Professor Marcel Breus, he's a professor of public international law from Groningen, to join us over there. And he will give a lecture. Marcel, please. The floor is yours, yeah. Marcel, I would like to hear some the topics like what's the role of the international community? Is it possible for Turkey to act outside the borders of Turkey? And how is it in legally, very old-fashioned legally, is it possible or is it illegal? Okay, you have about 50 minutes. Thank you so much, Marcel.
Thank you very much for this invitation here tonight. Just a few questions, you would say, which I cannot answer in full in 15 minutes. First, I have to take you to a different reality, because we just heard these touching stories. And now we have to go to a different level to analyze that from a perspective of law. And you might say, this is a professor of Groningen, he spent his whole life teaching international law, researching international law. Must be the most depressing job there is. Because what do we see in the world? Violations of international law. We had all these stories. We heard these stories, we've seen the pictures, or you will see the pictures. And we hear these stories every day in the newspaper, whether it's about this problem, whether it's about the invasion by Turkey in Syria, whether it's what's happening in Syria itself. So it seems to be a most depressing job to be a professor of international law. But on the other hand, these are the most difficult situations where international law has to deal with. When violence starts, then the law often is silent. It's very difficult at the moment that there is a fighting to really stick to the law. But there is one good thing about the law, and that's why I'm not a depressed person, and I'm still very optimistic about the role of international law. And that is that it in general sets standards. It sets standards, objective standards, where to measure this type of behavior. What is allowed, what is not allowed. And the second question is, if we find a breach of the law, what can we do about it? That is a difficult question. But without having the standards to judge what is possible, what is allowed and what is not, we are without any objective measurement. Then it's our own morality, and everybody's morality might be completely different. So that's the role of law, and that's why I think it's very important important to look at that. I will have in these 15 minutes not much time to talk to you about all kind of details, and I have to say also at the beginning that I'm not an expert in the facts of what is happening with the Kurdish people in Turkey, exactly all the facts of what happened when Turkey invaded Syria. I'm not an expert in that. I'm a lawyer, so I try to analyze this the situation. And there's in fact two situations which we are looking at. One is what we just heard, what's happening inside Turkey. And we have the situation that Turkey went across the border to dare to attack what it sees as enemies in Kurdish fighters in Syria. How can we judge that from an international legal perspective? And I think it's important that I don't know how much you know about international law. Maybe you know quite a bit, and then there's nothing new what I'm going to tell you. But there's four different circles of law which you could distinguish here, where we have to talk about if we want to say something about the legality. The first one is it legal for Turkey to use force against or in another state, in this case, Syria? The attack on Afrin, that whole area which is now occupied, is that in accordance with international law? Our starting point there is the Charter of the United Nations, that very important document which was agreed upon in 1945 and which is the basis of the United Nations. In that charter, we have the two most basic rules which deal with the use of force between states. And that is, states may only use force if they have the permission of the Security Council or if they act in self-defense, and I will come back to the self-defense. A last possibility would be that another state invites a state to assist that state with the use of force. So if the government of Syria, in this case, would have invited openly Turkey to help it in an internal position where it had to fight certain opposition forces of the Syrian government, it would have been possible according to international law. That is the first one. Is interstate use of force allowed? The second one is, if force is used in international relations or within a state, and there the two situations come together, if that is used, then we have quite a lot of rules which say what type of force can be used. And to say, make it very simple, to make sure that the force that is used is not more than what is necessary for the military or the security objectives of the persons using that force. That is both applicable in international conflicts, but also in internal conflicts, or what we call in international law, non-international armed conflicts. We talk then about the laws of war, or what is called international humanitarian law. And where in the first example I gave, that is the United Nations Charter, which forms the basis, in the second circle of law, there is we have, and you all have heard about that, the Geneva Conventions of 1949. They are the basis of that set of rules and customary international law, and so many more older treaties, but that is the core. That's the humanitarian law. But when we look now to the situation inside Turkey, we have another circle of law, which was already mentioned also, just very briefly, and that is human rights law, international human rights law. Even if there is not an open international or a non-international armed conflict within a state, then the state has to live up to its international human rights obligations. I'll come back to that. The right to life, the right to property. If all these houses are destroyed, then of course the right to property is completely violated. Or when this mass expropriation takes place, as it has happened. But another example, the prohibition of the use of torture, but also the freedom of opinion, the freedom of association. All these rights are a different circle of rights which are come into play when you want to analyze what is going on in this situation in Turkey and just across the border in Syria. Human rights law. There we have as important documents the many international human rights conventions. The two important human rights conventions of 1966, but also the Convention on the Right of the Child and the conventions against torture and ill treatment and many other international conventions. And for Europe, and Turkey is for that matter a European state, member of the Council of Europe, and party to the European Convention of Human Rights. That's also a very important document in this context. And finally, the fourth circle of law where we can look at is international criminal law. What can we do to prosecute in a criminal manner people who violate these rules in such a fundamental manner that the international community has said this cannot go unpunished? How can we punish these people? And then you can think about the International Criminal Court in The Hague. Or also, how can states prosecute persons from other states who have committed violations, serious violations of international humanitarian law? That's a fourth circle. All these circles are important to understand aspects of the problem and what to do about it. If we look at the situation and the invasion of Syria in Afrin, the Operation Olive Branch, I think the situation is quite clear. There we have a situation of clearly illegal use of force. Turkey claims that it can do so because it had to react in self-defense against attacks from that region to Turkey by the Kurdish forces. But there have been certain attacks, there was violence used, but the threshold of gravity has not been reached, and also the need to respond by the use of force, and certainly in the disproportional way it has been done, leads me to the conclusion that the invasion is, according to current international law, is clear illegal. We can speak about that more. I see that I only have 2 minutes left, so we can speak in the discussion more about that. The second point I want to very briefly say something about is the international humanitarian law. Of course, in the attacks on Afrin and other places there, Turkey has to respect the full set of rules which are applicable during an armed conflict. That means that you have to make a distinction between civilians and fighters. You have to be very cautionary in what whom you attack and how you attack them. You have to avoid unnecessary suffering, and also against the use of force must be proportional to the aims that you try to reach. And that is probably also in this case, it is what is being violated by Turkey in this context. If you look at the situation in Sur, then we have to analyze whether the fighting between the Kurdish people and the Kurdish and the Turkish state forces, whether that adds up to a non-international armed conflict. There we have to look at the intensity of the fighting. We have to look at whether the rebel forces, or in normal circumstances, in this case, the Kurdish forces, form a sufficiently strong organization with hierarchies and military commands in order to make them a party in a armed conflict, and also whether they have a degree of control over the territory. If that is the case, and if you come to the conclusion that that is the case, then we talk about a non-international armed conflict within Turkey. And in such a conflict, situations like what happened in Sur may arise. Force can be used by the state forces against the forces that oppose them. But again, then in that case, not the full series of international humanitarian law applies, but only the core fundamental rules, and that the minimum standards, and that is again humane treatment of people, making the distinction between civilians and fighters, and of course to avoid murder, torture, and unfair trial. If you come to the conclusion, and there I conclude, if you come to the conclusion that the situation in Turkey cannot be qualified as an internal armed conflict, then it is a situation where the security forces of Turkey found it necessary to undertake certain action against what they consider as a rebellious population, and then the human rights standards are applicable. And what we see here, and that is my I don't know all the details, and you can always say hide behind I don't know the details, so I cannot give a qualification. If I listen to these stories and what I know more about what is going on, it is quite clear, and there's of course, there have been cases that at that level is that Turkey is violating the most fundamental human rights rules, both at the international level and at the European level. We have to make a last remark here is that human rights can be limited if there's an emergency situation. If a country is under attack, if there is a serious threat to the country, to the stability of the country, a country can take measures which deviate from the ordinary human rights. But there are limits to that. And so the most fundamental human rights have to be respected. And what I've heard today and what I know about it, I think that Turkey would have a very difficult case to explain in this case. Thank you.
Use this microphone. Jan, can I give you this one, please, as well? Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Even kijken. Deze is. Ja, deze zijn schoon. Deze twee zijn schoon. Alleen een beetje water, ja. Okay. Now it's time to ask the three other members for the panel to join me here. Sinan Onal, would you please join me here over there, Sinan? Yes. And may I have Joel for the Wind? Would you please sit over there? And finally, Sadet Karabulut, would you please join me here? And please, all speak in the microphone, please. Sorry, yes. Yes. So everybody has his own microphone. Okay, so we saw Marcel and Sinan Onal. He's a representative of HDP in Germany. And Joel for the Wind is a member of the parliament in the Netherlands for the ChristenUnie. And right now you are in the government. Am I right? Yeah?
Coalition,
yes.
No, okay.
What?
He's number 76.
He's number 76. So just for people who are not familiar with the situation in Holland, we have 150 seats in the parliament. And thanks to his party, we have a majority for the government. So he's the 76th seat, 76th the majority. And Sadet, a member of the parliament in the Netherlands for the Socialist Party, SP. Just the first question, Marcel just said told about the attacks, whether they were justified internally or outside, and in his opinion, hoe zeg je het goed in goed Nederlands? Hoe je het went of keer, how would you like it? You know, it doesn't matter how you like it, you look at it, it's all wrong. Am I right? Yeah, I'm looking at you just to have that point clear. Is that right to establish that it doesn't matter how you look at the actions of Turkey government right now, whether it's internal or outside Turkey, it's wrong? Can we subscribe that? Three of you?
Yes.
Yes?
Of course.
Joel?
It's clear.
And graag in de microfoon vanaf nu. Ja, en Joel voor de wind, Christian, ja. Je kan het een beetje naar je toe trekken. Of als Marvin niet naar de berg kan, dan gaat de microfoon naar de berg. Ja. En so, what's your reply?
Yes, well, we waited a long time for the evidence because Turkey said it was. It had a reason to attack Afrin because they proclaimed that they were attacked from Syrian ground to Turkey.
Yeah.
And we've waited, I think now 3 or 4 months for the evidence, and they haven't shown the evidence.
Yeah.
So as long as they don't apply to the evidence, then of course it's they cannot justify the attack on Afrin.
Yeah, so that's the outside part. And how about the inside part? Are we agree about that, that even what they did in Turkey itself, it's also against the law?
When they attack civilians, innocent civilians.
Yeah. In Sur, in Diyarbakir.
Whenever they attack innocent civilians, then of course that's a violation of human rights.
Yeah. Sinan, do you have something to, would you like to add to this?
Actually, it is not only violation of human rights, it is not only violation of international law process that just already Professor Marcel underlined based on the UN conventions. It's more than it. I should clearly say that it is at least semi-genocide against the people, because we right now talk about a suddenly disappeared old city with its old population.
Yeah.
So it comes to me that in just the very limited context of the human rights conventions, it cannot be explained.
Yeah.
It should be rather more sophisticatedly explained for bringing these actors to the Hague court and really define the exact crime of it.
Okay. Yeah. Okay, let's talk about that. First of all, how should international community react to this? I'm asking especially you, but four of you, know what's the role of international community when they are doing these horrible attacks inside and outside? What can we do?
Well, what should we do? I think there are lots of things to do. For example, let's start with my party, the Socialist Party. I was in the area in southeastern part of Turkey in 2014 and 2015. In 2014, I was in Diyarbakir, and yes, there were problems, but it wasn't destroyed, you know? And in 2015, I was in Nusaybin and Cizre, and I was one of the delegations that tried to get in there to see what was happening. And what has been told, it's true, you know? What we see is true, that they are attacking civilians. And I also spoke to a mother. She lost her daughter. I think she was like 8, 9 years. I don't remember exactly anymore. But she had to keep her own daughter in this fridge because they didn't let her go out of her home to bury her daughter. These things has happened. Yeah, yeah. Oh, my God. Yeah, yeah. And it is amazing. And I was thinking about it when I just came in. I went to see the beautiful pictures. Thanks for that, and also thanks to Kurtz and friends for organizing this. I was thinking, okay, so nothing has changed. And it's quite amazing, right? And of course we are talking about, so if you ask me what can you do, we can show our solidarity to start with. I think it's very important to see the pictures, to tell the stories, to receive MPs. And I think it's very important that we, me as a parliamentarian, that I take this issue again and again in parliament, because what we see is that we're forgetting about it. And the problems are so big with this regime in Turkey, and they are growing. And every time that, because he has a big problem, Erdogan. Of course, he's strong. And he still has a majority, but there are lots of people in Turkey who are opposing. Yeah. And every time when there's a threat, he starts attacking, sometimes inside of Turkey, sometimes outside of Turkey. Yeah. And now we see this illegal invasion in Syria. Yeah. And that's really crazy for international relations. It's, of course, crazy. Here we had this monster of IS attacking the Yazidis, minorities, Kurdish people. We had the Kurdish people fighting against them. IS. The whole the world were talking about the heroes, and they are, of course. And now we have this situation that Turkey is attacking these people, and instead of the Kurdish people who are living there, they are now jihadis taking their land and their homes. That's unacceptable.
Okay, so let me, by the way, I have only for about maybe 10 minutes more questions, and then I would like to see some hands in the air. So
maybe one more thing. And what is really amazing, but that's how it works with international law, it's also, you know, they have different measures. For example, when there is a gas attack in Syria, which we don't know, of course it's awful, but we don't have the proofs. They attack with bombs, you know, the Western countries, some Western countries, and also our government supports it. Yeah. And when there's this illegal invasion, nobody even condemns. Yeah. How is this possible? Yeah. So if you ask me what has to happen, we have to start condemning this.
And if I hear you, you and your party are totally condemning all these actions of Turkey.
Yeah, not only of Turkey, but all the illegal action, because, of course, states have the right to defend themselves, but also people, they have the right of self-determination. They also have the right to defend themselves within the international law.
Let's go to Joel for the win. So that was a very clear attitude of this party in this conflict. Where are you standing?
Well, the first question was pretty simple. Yeah. The second question, of course, what can the international community do, is very more complicated, because we've talked about it in Parliament for many times to condemn Turkey on these acts. And in the end, of course, the coalition also condemned the action, and we wanted to do it together with the UN and with the European partners. It's the motion of Van Helfert. Yeah. Which was accepted in Parliament. But of course, there the problem starts, because you can do it on your own, but then what will happen? So as a coalition, we insisted that we do it together with the European Union and with the UN. Yeah. And there it's a big problem, because in the European Union even, there is not a majority to do it, to condemn and to put pressure on Turkey, even not with the Germans.
Even not with Germans?
No.
I mean, you live in Germany. Please tell us about how that works.
Unfortunately, particularly German country, German government, based on their very long-standing and great financial and etc. relations with Turkey, they couldn't stand on a very EU-valued point towards the Turkish aggression policies, whether against the Sousse and Cizre and the other Kurdish cities, and also the Afrin aggression. Yeah. Unfortunately, it was a great disappointment on behalf of the EU values. Yeah. All the Kurds and the Turkish Democrats and all the Turkey population who are very complaint against Erdogan really felt very much disappointed. not only towards Ms. Merkel, who was representing the conservatives, but also the Social Democrats, who was the second great part of the coalition of the Germany. So still this process ongoing. And just like Joel underlined, there was some very opportunistic and very pragmatic policies of the Germany and all EU community based on their migration deal. And this migration deal was the key of the process that make all of the community silent against these crimes against humanity.
Do you think that that Erdogan used, or maybe misused, abused the migration deal to attack people in Afrin, to Kurds in Syria?
Yeah, actually, I should really mention it that,
so that is
millions of the public eye thinks in this way. Yeah. You know, it is not an only subjective approach of me and my colleagues.
Yeah.
Because the trauma of the refugees and the great migration waves in this very chaotic financial economic situation of EU community made them behave hostage in a very opportunistic and two-faced way, unfortunately. Yeah.
It's even bigger.
Where does that leave us when it comes to EU deal with Turkey?
Well, the problem is even bigger because apparently there was a deal between Turkey and Assad and the Russians to give up Afrin in the end game of dividing Syria into different spheres with the Sunnis, the Shiites, and the Kurds. And you see is the same kind of cynical end game as we had before in former Yugoslavia and Bosnia, where, of course, the war was ended, but before the war ended, the Serbs were given parts of the land. And that's what's happened as well in Syria nowadays, that they divided the land and they agreed even with the Americans that this part would be given to Turkey and the part behind the Euphrates would be safeguarded by the Americans. So it's a bigger end game of all the superpowers even. So cynical is it.
Marcel, would you like to add something?
Yes, I think that is clear. We can talk a very long time about these geopolitics and all the complexities there. Yeah. But I think it remains important not to use that as a shield for us here in the Netherlands, for example, to say, oh, we are a small country, we cannot do anything because the European Union, we don't get sufficient support. I think it remains of great importance to continuously reiterate that the standards which you want to measure this behavior to.
Cool.
You cannot, but I want to say one thing more, which I think is very important. You can also support organizations, not necessarily the parties on the ground, but people, for example, who gather evidence of what is happening.
Yeah.
Because that is what That's we see good. Now for all these atrocities, not only there, but in other parts of the world, is that when it often you see 5, 10, some decades later, that people are being held to account for what they are doing. But you need the evidence. So helping people to gather evidence about what's happening. And that is also what something sometimes can be done.
That's the thing the Netherlands did. Huh? We organized a center here in Holland that collects data, built a foundation for the accusations of genocide also in Syria as well as in Iraq, concerning also the ISIS commitments.
Yeah. By the way, can I ask, make a maybe cynical remark? You know, just one more thing about this Turkey deal. So the Turkey deal was to get less refugees, asylum seekers here. But with this whole attack, they are generating more refugees at the same time.
Sure.
So it's.
Yeah, you know, I think we could do more. It's true, and I think the fact that the EU governments and also our government, because they could do more, I do agree on that. Is that Rutte is, of course, together with Diederik Samson, one of the architects of this Turkey deal, And all the EU governments, they do have some problems also with their internal politics and the right-wing populist parties growing. So they are searching for these kinds of solutions, which aren't solutions, and they are giving away from the values that we are so proud on.
Yeah.
And I think we could do more still at this moment also. We could, for example, Turkey wants to be part of the European Union. We could make some, we could agree on some conditions, you know? Why shouldn't we ask Turkey to release the political prisoners, for example, and then say, okay, if you don't do this, then we will put on hold, totally on hold, the talks for getting part of the European Union. Turkey, Erdogan, is very dependent for his economy also of the European countries.
Thank you for the question.
A second thing that we could do is ask him to withdraw from Afrin. You know, we could make the talks a little bit more conditional on, for us, important points.
And Joël, you act like...
No. It's already happened, of course, because of the situation and the attempted coup, because of the human rights situation, because so many people were arrested, so many people were fired. The whole negotiations with the EU membership is already frozen. So, even that's cynical because the Netherlands, there's a humanity, unity in the Dutch government, Dutch parliament, to completely stop the negotiations. But then whenever the Dutch go into the European Union, they say there's no majority to even cut completely the funds that we still pay for the negotiations. So that's how cynical it is.
Yeah.
But at this moment, the negotiations are frozen, but still we pay money. Now, we did a little trick to deviate the money that we pay to the Turkish government to give it to the civil society, which is a good step.
Yeah.
But still, I think my party thinks that we should completely cut the aid to Turkey right away.
Okay, I didn't know that, by the way. Maybe it's me, but I didn't know that.
There was a motion, and it's totally agreed on in the Dutch parliament.
Something else is, when we, and I'll just go to a completely different topic. Oh, the microphone a bit closer, okay. Is if you think about what happened with the MH17, the airplane which was shot by a Buk, a missile which allegedly comes from Russia. There the Dutch government says, we will use all legal means to our disposal to find the perpetrators, to bring them to justice. And we also hold Russia to account. We have held them in the state
of something very exceptional.
And in this sentence, if we as the Netherlands say what is happening in Sur or perhaps in Afrin is really violating in a fundamental way the values of the European Convention of Human Rights, for example, there are legal means also under that convention for the Netherlands to take action.
Referring to dear Marcel and also Joël, I should remind them again the EU experience of the Turkey started with Maastricht criteria.
Yeah.
You know, and the Maastricht criteria in 1999, acceptance of all of these convention of the rules, made Turkey restart a democratic travel towards the Western values.
Yeah.
And right now, we have witnessing all the violation of this criteria. And Netherlands...
Except for the refugee deal.
Except of the refugee deal. And actually, I should also say that comparing and contrasting to the post-Cold War era, just like Joël underlined, the Yugoslavia tragedy and genocides, the things that international law couldn't do that time, and the standpoint that international law experts and the Hague Court couldn't do that time, right now it is the time to do it, because we are experiencing an hegemonical war in the Middle East, a power vacuum in between very great global forces and the Kurds, who have no recognition, identity, cannot be deprived of their fundamental human rights based on these conflicts. So international law have too many things can do, yeah. And the Netherlands politicians, yeah, have too many things can do for the Turkish and Kurdish people.
Yeah. Okay. Sure. Two. Or do you mean two with T-O-O?
T-O-O.
Definitely.
Okay. T-O-O, okay. By the way, that's my final question, and I will then time for you to ask questions. I heard the story that the Arab refugees in the neighborhood of Damascus, when they were released by Bashar government, they sent them to Afrin and the other areas to populate those Kurdish area by the Arab people. Hmm. You heard about this?
Yeah, we should ask the Turks, because I heard this. I also, yeah, heard that the refugees from Afrin, the people, the Kurdish people, yeah, from Afrin, that they are now in the refugee camps in Greece.
Yeah.
You know, you see this deal. Yeah. It's opening the doors for these people, yeah, who fight against yeah, IS. So we heard about this, but I spoke to the director of ICRC, and I asked him, how is the humanitarian situation at this moment in Afrin? He said, we don't know. We don't have any entrance.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
They don't allow international organizations to get into Afrin.
Yeah. But just to...
And this is, I think, this is a policy, what has happened also in the past and is happening at this moment.
The process of Arabization of the Kurdish area, you know, like ethnic cleansing going on right now.
Sure, actually.
You heard about that?
Yeah, definitely. Just before the attacks to the Afrin, the occupation attacks of the Turkish government, the one-third population of the Afrin was consisting of the Arab people, yeah, who already got asylum in the Afrin, you know? Mm-hmm. So they were hosted by Afrin people. Yeah. And Afrin was a safe haven, yeah, for many millions of the Syrian people at that time. Okay. And there was nothing about self-defense of Turkish government. There was nothing about disproportional attacks against each other. It was very evidently an occupation attacks, which was violating NATO, the fifth article, and the UN conventions, and the conventions in between nation states. Yeah. Albeit violating all of these conventions, the international political community just kept silent. Sorry. Against this tragedy.
Let's have some questions for about 10 minutes, and as I said, we will round up with Nursel for the last 5 minutes. Okay, there's a question. I just come to you so you can stand up and speak in the microphone because we are recording it. Thank you.
Yes. My name is Peshmerga. I have a question for Joel and for Saadat. Recently, the Dutch government has cancelled the non-lethal assistance to Idlib because of radical groups, Islamic groups, and HTS, or Hayat Tahrir al-Sham, formerly known as Jabhat al-Nusra of Al-Qaeda in Syria, was reason of it. Yeah. Turkey has attacked Afrin, where my parents still live, under pretext of fighting terrorist organization, which has ties with designated terrorist group PKK. Turkey now in Syria has ties with HTS, which is also a designated terrorist organization by the US. And the US have confirmed that. I wonder how the Dutch government or Netherlands, what is the responsibility of you? Because Turkey is a NATO member. Do you do anything to question Turkey about its ties with HTS? HTS Al-Qaeda, which threatened the whole West, Western world, and America. So I wonder, how do you act on that?
Yeah. Thank you so much, Peshmerga. Yeah. So, question for you, members of parliament.
Well, we have asked many parliamentarian questions and also in the debates on the ties from Turkey with terrorists in Syria and the links and providing arms. I was in Syria myself, and even I saw the ISIS or former Al-Qaeda fighters going up and forth on the Turkish border. But all the time, the Netherlands governments, it's not have been any questions lately, but in the previous government, they denied any connections between Al-Qaeda and Turkey. And they said, well, we checked with Turkey, and they say there are no connections with Al-Qaeda. So then we said, well, how can you ask Turkey? It's ridiculous to ask Turkey. You should investigate. You should put forward a UN investigation. But until now, it's very sensitive, of course, because we are part of the NATO, and it's very sensitive to do an investigation to your own ally within the NATO. So they are very hesitant to go even into this question. Yeah. And even I think Sadat and I were very much opposed any support from the Dutch government to the Free Syrian Army because we knew it was interrelated to Jabhat al-Nusra. So we were happy, and we forced the government to stop the support for the non-lethal aid. We asked in a resolution to deviate the aid to the Kurdish groups, to the Syrian Democratic Council. And that resolution was accepted, but still the aid continued to the Free Syrian Army, which was very regrettable.
Yeah, very short, in addition to what Joël told, there are two things. I think one thing is that we all know that the ugly war in Syria, which started as the Syrian people opposing Assad, is now returned into a proxy war. And we all do know, including the NATO countries, including our own government, that some allies like Turkey, but also the Gulf countries, that they do support jihadist groups. We know. And they did it, they let them do, because they wanted to get rid of Assad. Now, a couple of years later, and a couple of thousands, hundreds and thousands of deaths, people, we know that Assad is very strong. The second thing is, in addition to what we did in Dutch Parliament, just recently our colleague Peter Omtzigt from the Christian Democrats, he asked again questions, because we also do want to know that, where does the Dutch non-lethal aid go to which groups? And we don't get this information from the government. And they say that's because of security reasons, but I don't get this. You don't have to give all details. So the parliament is really working on this, but this is the situation. And that's why I think that giving weapons to countries like Saudi Arabia, Qatar, or Turkey, we shouldn't do this. We shouldn't do this, because we know that it's abuse. We know that it's there are too many weapons. They use it also against their own population. But sometimes, and we have these examples, they get in hands of the jihadi groups.
Yeah, yeah. Nog een vraag over? Yeah.
Neville Chifchi, a lawyer from the Netherlands. I have a question for our MPs. The international way to bring justice, to bring Erdogan and the government is a long and a difficult way. But if I suggest a concrete step, and that's the national way. The Dutch government can decide to go after people who are in the Netherlands, and I'm talking about the Gulen people. There are generals in Holland. There are soldiers in Holland. They are away from Turkey because they have now a big fight with Erdogan, but there is evidence that they were in the war in Sur and Cizre, Nusaybin. So, but the questions to the at OM, the prosecutor, mm-hmm. There is a special office, and we asked them if they were planning to prosecute those people mm-hmm. in Holland. And they are saying, no, we don't have any plans and we won't interfere in that case. So Will the MPs here, can you put pressure at the Minister of Justice to go after these people? You know?
A very interesting point, I guess. Yeah.
To this question, the reason for not prosecuting in the Netherlands is because the police says we do not consider the situation a non-international armed conflict, and that's why we don't have a mandate. So a very concrete proposal following my neighbor is, if the parliament says we consider the situation, especially in the southeast of Turkey in 2015, was a non-international armed conflict, so the international crimes units of the police can prosecute. That's a bit more concrete than showing solidarity to people.
Okay, very concrete, interesting question, maybe also for Marcel at the end. So first the politicians, please. Three of you.
Yeah, I think you mentioned this issue one more time before to me. I think it's very interesting because I'm not a specialist in law. I can't say yes, we will do this, but we can work on this together. So if you give me the documentation that you have, we could at least look at what we could do to
How
work together
you,
on this.
Have you heard about this angle in this whole case before?
No, but I also have to look into it. This is new for me, but it seems that it will be very difficult to do it from Holland, because then the prosecutor has to find evidence of a war in Turkey that where the Netherlands was not part of. So then you're actually looking to an international tribunal to put it forward.
Maybe you could explain this. Is this indeed like Joel tells, or do you have proof in your case, etc.?
Wait a minute, I come to you. Yeah. But please bear in mind, you know, it's 10:05. So, you know, at the end, there are some people, believe it or not, they don't live in Amsterdam. No, I have to go back to Almere Musikwerk, you know? Okay.
No, very concrete. We have a lot of documentation and evidence. So it's about, for example, a very high person in the army who is now asking for asylum in Europe. There are a lot of soldiers and even generals. And they decided to bomb the houses and they decided to kill innocent people. And there are a lot of reports and evidences. So it's for the Dutch the prosecutor to say you committed war crimes, am I right? And there is evidence, so we will investigate. And then they can collect their evidence on their themselves.
So they don't even want to investigate right now. Can I link you up together?
Of course.
Later, yes. Exchange, you know, email address, everything. Okay. Cool. Cool. As I said, it's 10:05. So I just want to hear just one final remark. You know, maybe on a higher level, like you just said something about, you know, the whole army trade, you know, with Saudi Arabia. You know, if we zoom out, this is not something that just happened 2 years ago, 1 year ago. Yeah. It, you know, Turkey has been a good suspect for all this stuff, you know.
Yeah, but
so
you know,
what does it say?
I think it's very important. It started, of course, hopefully with Erdogan. Everybody was pessimistic, and me too. But I had something like, okay, he has been chosen democratically, we should give him a chance. Now we do know that there's no rule of law. We know that hundreds of people are jailed. We know about all these atrocities. We know that they are in Syria, so we must act. And there's not one thing that we can do. There are lots of things that we can do. And for me, it's important that we work on this issue in the parliament and together with the people who are fighting there, of course. And when we talk about war and weapons and war crimes, then the first thing that we should do is stop selling arms to these countries.
Joel, what's your final note on this subject?
Well, of course, I hope that Afrin will be freed from Turkey in our lifetime, I hope soon, for the people that come from Afrin, because we've all read the Human Rights Watch report on what's happening now with the Kurdish people, the other minorities that live there, that are oppressed, they have to wear the files again, and so the situation is deteriorating at this moment. I think we should look at more ways internationally. It's a little bit cynical, but hopefully even Syria wants to regain its sovereignty over its own land. So maybe the international community, not helping Assad, but do proclaim that Syria is a sovereign land. So they should, in the end, return to their own borders. Otherwise, it will be a chaos internationally if we allow, as an international community, that this land will be taken for a long time.
Okay. Cool. Yeah. Sinan, what's your final note?
Yeah, actually, there are too many things to be spoken. But it's really great that to speak these issues, discuss and debate. We should deepen and enlarge our horizon of discussions about these issues, not only for Kurdish people or for Middle Eastern people, but for facing our very essence of human beings. You know, we need to remind our real values. We are, as HDP party, right now running for presidency and parliamentary election.
Next Sunday. Yes, so I know. Yeah.
It will be a great revenge of our people democratically done against this government.
Yeah.
And we are right now as the third choice for the Turkey electorate, standing in a very strategic point.
Yeah.
Maybe can be compared with the my dear colleagues, political party in the government.
Yeah.
You know, with our appearance in the Turkish political spectrum right now, neither Mr. Erdogan nor Mr. Ince can get the victory.
Yeah.
So as the third choice, based on the labor values, freedom values, democratic values, we are about to legitimize ourselves in the political spectrum of the Turkey and EU spectrum. But we need very great support of our people, our friends living in Netherlands especially, to go and to observe the elections in the Turkey.
Yeah.
And at least they will be able to discourage some dirty games of the manipulations.
Okay.
And we will more or less have a fair election. And
inshallah.
Inshallah. We are very, very much trust ourselves that we can restart
a new
democracy spring.
Yeah.
We can re-bring Turkey to the democracy and we can stop all these violations by bringing these actors to the Hague court into the very service of my dear professor.
Yes, dear professor, final note for you. You heard some...
Two very brief final notes. I think one thing is, and that's also for our members of parliament, is that we should not, as the Netherlands, assist in undermining international law by legitimizing the type of behavior that Turkey takes and the arguments it uses for... going into Afrin and taking part of Syria.
Yeah.
Second point is law is about accountability. And therefore, I also think we should continue to strengthen how to hold, if we cannot hold states to account, then we should hold individuals to account. And there are lots of obstacles to do that, but I think that's also one way of showing that you take it seriously. And we do that. In the Netherlands, we prosecute people who have come here from other countries, from Ethiopia, and we prosecute them for what they have done in sometimes a very far past.
That's
that we
right.
Do. And so it's a difficult way, but it should be possible.
But it's, we have done it. Okay. Mr. Bruce and Onal for the wind. And Karabulut, thank you so much for joining us here. And I'm going to link you up with those ladies, lawyers over there. Thank you again. Okay, you can go back. Okay. So the final minutes, maybe Besh, minutes, okay, for you? Okay, Ariel, would you please join me here? We are going to run a roundup. Okay, I'm going to sit over here, take your microphone. And it's a very, very short question for you, Nursel. You heard all these remarks, stories. What's your final note?
Burada hikayeler duydunuz, konuşmaları duydunuz. Sizin son söyleyeceğiniz söz nedir?
Bence hem bizim açımızdan, HDP açısından, hem de Kürt halkının beklentileri açısından son derece önemli ve değerli fikirlerin açığa çıktığı bir toplantı oldu.
And for the verwachtingen van het van HDP en van Koerdisch volk zien we heb ik gezien hier dat het heel erg hoopvol is.
Erdoğan Kürtlere karşı bir savaş suçu işledi, insanlık suçu işledi.
Erdoğan heeft de Koerden is hij een oorlogsmisdadiger geweest. En ook tegen de menselijkheid.
Yani bize göre uluslararası hukuk çerçevesinde mutlaka yargılanması gerekir.
Hij moet zeker berecht worden volgens internationaal recht.
Türkiye'de şu an seçimler var. Erdoğan'ın rakipleri, yani bizim dışımızdaki rakipleri Erdoğan'ı emekliye göndereceklerini, artık evde torunlarına bakması gerektiğini söylüyorlar.
En ook dus niet alleen maar wij als HDP, maar ook voor partijen zoals CHP en op andere oppositiepartij die wil heel graag dat Erdoğan nu met pensioen gaat en op zijn kleinkinderen gaat passen. Want we zijn nu bezig met verkiezingen en daarom hopen wij dat allemaal.
Ja. Ama hayır, biz öyle söylemiyoruz. Ja. Evet, Erdoğan kaybedecek bu seçimlerde ama Kürtlere karşı işlediği insanlık suçları nedeniyle mutlaka yargılanacak.
Wij als HDP, dus de oppositie zegt wel van laten we maar nu met pensioen gaan op zijn kinderen passen. Maar wij als HDP zeggen nee, hij moet zeker berecht worden.
İnancım odur ki ABD'de Erdoğan'ı İran'a yönelik yaptırımları deldiği için yargılayacak.
En ik denk ook dat Amerika ook naar aan de hand van de beschuldigingen die ook zijn geweest richting Turkije met de embargo richting Iran, hè, dat hij dat dus daar dus ook een rol heeft gespeeld, daar zou Amerika dus hem ook voor berechten. Daar geloof ik in.
Ja.
Değerli konuşmacıların da belirttiği gibi Afrin'i işgal ettiği için orada 1500'e yakın Kürt vatandaşının ölümüne neden olduğu için yargılanacak.
Ook wat er allemaal in Afrin is gebeurd, wat we net ook allemaal hebben gehoord. Er zijn daar volgens cijfers 1500 mensen zijn daar om het leven gekomen.
Bir milletvekili olarak şahitliğini ve tanıklığını yaptığım IŞİD'e yardımları ve katkıları olduğu için yargılanacak.
Ik als parlementariër geloof ook dat hij wat hij allemaal samen en samen met de islamitische dus samen met de Daesh heeft gedaan dat hij daarom ook berecht zal worden.
Biz onun yargılanacağı günü bekliyoruz.
En wij wachten op de dag dat hij berecht zal worden.
Ik hoop het. İnşallah.
Son olarak şunu belirtmek istiyorum. Elbette ki Türkiye'de yaşananlar için yapılacak her zaman bir şey vardır.
Er is altijd iets om te doen voor wat er allemaal in Turkije is gebeurd.
Örneğin Sur'a yönelik saldırılar sırasında Avrupa Birliği, Avrupa Parlamentosu'ndan gelen milletvekili arkadaşlarımız olmasaydı bizlerle birlikte Sur içindeki mahsur kalmış olan sivilleri çıkartmak için bir çabamız olmasaydı.
Als de Europarlementariërs die waren gekomen, als zij niet destijds kwamen naar Turkije, als wij niets hadden gedaan voor de mensen in Sur.
İnanın, bizim içeriden çıkarttığımız 65 kişi, 15 tanesi de çocuk. Şu anda yaşıyor olmayacaklardı.
Geloof me, dan zouden die dus de mensen die we hebben gered, in dit geval dus 65 mensen, die zouden dus niet die zouden dus om het leven komen. Die zouden ja.
Bu dayanışma şu anda 65 kişinin hayatta olmasını sağladı.
Met al die steun die we hebben gekregen, hebben we ervoor gezorgd dat dus die 65 mensen dus hun leven hebben gered.
Bu bile bence bir insanı yaşatma adına çok önemli bir şey.
Zelfs dit is heel belangrijk om dus in dit geval dus mensen dat ze dus in leven kunnen blijven.
Ben buradan herkese teşekkür ediyorum.
Ik dank iedereen die er vandaag aanwezig was.
Jij ook dan.
Het is des allens, des allens geweest.
I'm going to wrap up, of course, the four members of the panel just a couple of minutes ago. Thank you so much for joining us here. Thank you, thank you, thank you, and thank you. And of course...
Mag ik nog
ja, dat heb je met die parlementariërs.
Laatste keer.
Waar ze ook vandaan komen.
Şu anda biliyorsunuz seçimler var.
Zoals jullie weten zijn nu Sur, verkiezingen.
Evet, Sur işgali sırasında tam 3 ay boyunca, evet tam 3 ay boyunca iki çocuğuyla birlikte Sur'da kalan bir kadın arkadaşımız şu anda Diyarbakır'dan HDP milletvekili adayıdır ve seçilecek. Eğer bundan sonra böyle bir toplantı yapmak isterseniz ve Sur'da gerçek anlamda neler yaşandığını öğrenmek isterseniz arkadaşımızı artık bir milletvekili olarak buraya davet edebilirsiniz.
Ya Erdal?
Ik hou het kort. Nou, zij heeft dus net ook verteld hè, dat er dus mensen daar dus levend uit zijn gekomen. En een van die mensen dus is een mevrouw die is nu ook verkiesbaar in Turkije. Dus die is, zij is dus.
Fantastisch.
Ja, en zij is dus ook. Als zij dus in het parlement komt, is ook iets van hè, wat zij dus vanuit Sur, dus echt een iemand die dat ook heeft meegemaakt, die dan ook daar in het parlement dus daarvoor kan opkomen.
Ik hoop
en soru geldi ismi naam
Fehime Tosun.
Remziye Tosun.
Okay. Maar now I'm going to wrap up. Really, yeah? Okay. Nursul and Erdal, thank you so much. And as I said in the beginning, this event is organized by the Kurds and Friends and the Bali. And on behalf of Kurds and Friends, I would like to especially thank Carla von Oss and Reber Doski, who helped me to get prepared for this evening, and Jante Mosselman namens the Bali. Thank you so much. Thank you for being here. So if you want to watch the together like a private tour, special private tour with Pete, so we can go upstairs right now, Pete, with you. Okay. Thank you again. Okay. Ga in vrede.